And again, I just want to thank you for being here. And I hope that you found the breakout sessions useful and informative. I think that hopefully you're getting a sense that this is just not a strategic plan and that we're going to do more discovery. The idea here is to actually convert discovery into things that actually impact. It's about impact, and will be measured primarily on the basis of reduction in mortality. And that will come through a diversity of activities across the beachfront of the cancer care continuum. The other point that I want to make is that you've heard about specific cancers. Those are the cancers that we felt and the review committee felt, both internal, external, that those particular cancers are at a very significant point in the history of the field, where we've got a lot of actionable information that we can clearly have a line of sight towards reduction in mortality in this decade. Significant, not the 1% declines that we've experienced, happily so, over the last decade each year, but to really drive things more substantively. For those of you who attended the lung cancer moonshot, that early detection strategy alone, just that one project, has the opportunity to save tens of thousands of lives per year just by catching the cancer earlier. Very exciting project. And so that's an important thing to appreciate. The other thing is that what we learn from those cancers will impact broadly across all cancers, and we are not diminishing our investment in the other cancers that we have embarked on. In fact, the platforms that we're creating, for example, the Mouse Hospital, we are building the ability to test drugs that are directed against brain cancer, pancreas cancer, colon cancer, et cetera, the ones that were not selected. So the platforms are going to be broadly enabling for the entire program. The clinical genomics infrastructure that we're building is going to enable us as well. One of the most exciting projects is the leukemia project, which is one of these adaptive learning projects that, if you went to that breakout session, we're going to take not just AML or CLL, but many forms of leukemia and enlist the next 1,000 patients into whole genome sequencing pre-treatment, shortly after treatment, to look at how the tumor is adapting and maybe give us ideas about combinations, et cetera, in real time. And then if resistance occurs and the disease reemerges, to understand the mechanisms of resistance and so on. So even that approach alone, which could be easily applied to prostate cancer, the pilot efforts there, ovarian cancer, and so on. So what we do in one particular cancer is going to be broadly applicable from an infrastructure standpoint and a knowledge standpoint, and everything's going to be driving things forward. In the context of the knowledge gap, remember the areas where we don't have enough knowledge and we need to be able to close those gaps in order to then be in a position to have a flagship project that reduces mortality. Those knowledge gap efforts are in all cancer areas. They're not restricted in any way, shape, or form to the moonshot specifically. But we want to connect the dots, again, to reduction in mortality, so the mentality there is different. One thing that I want to stress is that no one has done this before. There's no mechanisms where we can go ahead and apply for a moonshot grant at the NIH. We're doing things and developing platforms that no one has developed before. And so we don't have the ability to generate funding avenues that are traditional. That will come as a result of this, and that's part of our plan, our financial modeling plan. But there is absolutely no question that the only way that we can actually get this going is to prime the pump with philanthropic activity. So this is extremely important for us to understand that in this inaugural effort, we've got to find the capital that is not readily available through other sources. And in fact, those other sources have been contracting over time. You might know that the NIH budget over the last 10 years has declined in real dollars by 19%. So it's not like our federal government is putting more resources into the solutions that can solve the big problems for the diseases that our society faces. Similarly, there's been a loss of hundreds of billions of dollars in market capitalization for large pharmaceutical companies, so it's not like they're flush with cash and be able to throw it into academic pursuits, et cetera, and their interests become increasingly more contracted on market decisions as opposed to societal need, things like early detection, prevention, and so on. Those kinds of things need to be supported, and they're supported through these kinds of efforts, through philanthropy. Now, part of what we're going to be doing, because we're going to be creating assets or knowledge that will be far more mature and more valuable, for example, a drug or a diagnostic, when we license that into the private sector, that is going to be able to be returned back in, and we'll plow it back into our research program and the moonshots to be able to then make this an evergreen situation. So the way that we envision this from a financial modeling standpoint is that we front end this with philanthropy to the greatest extent possible, foundations, separate types of funding mechanisms, etc., a little bit of NIH support. Then as we generate great data, we'll be able to secure more competitively grants from the federal government, foundations, and a variety of other things. And then as we mature assets and develop them, and we then sell the rights to those or license the rights, that will then bring commercial revenues, private sector resources back into the system, and we can keep the whole thing going ad infinitum. I have to say that Pat Mulvey and his team have done a spectacular job, and thanks to the region, we have approval for a very modern, innovative, integrated plan to raise philanthropic funds through synergistic integration of communications, development, marketing, as well as corporate relations. We're going to be embarking on cause marketing, e-philanthropy. We have so many patients around the world that come to us, so we're going to be taking that stage and trying to harness its goodwill, and so on and so forth. So we are not sitting still. We are working as hard as we possibly can and figuring out every possible mechanism for us to really move the needle on this disease. But if there's one thing that is the greatest risk for this project, it ain't will, smarts, technology, and all of those things. It is simply about resources. And we need the resources as soon as possible. And the sooner we get started and the more robustly we get started, the sooner we'll be in a position to be able to change the course of this disease once and for all. So I'd encourage you to look over that The Time Is Now book that in your bags and visit our cancermoonshots.org website for additional information on specific moonshots, platforms, and leaders. I have to say that when I came here to MD Anderson, this idea was one that was nascent and poorly formed in my own mind. But when I learned of the tremendous capacity and collaborative spirit and just sheer talent and infrastructure of this institution, there really is no other institution like this in the world. It is only focused on cancer. Everything that we do is about cancer. We go all the way from prevention through to survivorship. We've got hundreds of faculty that focus on just one disease. And so we have this depth of talent. From stem to stern at this institution, we absolutely hate and despise cancer. Everybody understands what the mission is of this institution. It's one thing, which is to cure cancer. You ask anyone, gardener, board of visitor, somebody working in accounts, they will tell you exactly the same thing. So this institution is really a very special one. And it really wants to take on the responsibility to articulate an effort like this. And to the extent that you can help us, that would be not only greatly appreciated, but frankly, you know, our kids and their kids are counting on us because of the huge societal impact, economic impact that this disease and other diseases is going to extract from our society in the decades ahead. So we've got to really get a running start on this, get the job done. This is a plan that could not have been planned or articulated even just a few years ago. We really are at a very special turning point. We sense it. We know that the field is right. We want to do this collaboratively with others around the world. But somebody's got to get started, and you've got to help us out. We can't just do it alone. So we're a team here, and we need everybody's help, the entire society, all of you, your financial support, but also your knowledge as well. Some of you bring very special backgrounds to help us think about issues relating to communications, organization, a variety of different things are ways to contribute to really enable us to move forward with this. So with that, I'll end.